You're listening to Puck and Roll.
Anticipated, we got a new GM episode. Welcome, one and all, to Puck and Roll. Patrick Forte here alongside Scott Cowan, Sebastian Hyde, Joshua Rosa. Full house tonight, boys. And it is, there's only one thing to talk about today, and we're going to be spending the majority of the episode talking about it, of course. We got a new GM in Kent Hughes. Now, a little bit controversial, only because we live in Quebec, because if we're anywhere else in the NHL, everybody would be cool with it. But, you know, this is a gentleman from La Belle Province with an Anglophone last name, so everyone is kind of bitter about that, but who cares? So this is Jeff Gorton's choice. Pretty sure it has been his choice since the very beginning, but we'll dissect that in a little bit. But first, let's go around the table and let's get everyone's opinion as to what they think about this is a new general manager. And let's start with Mr. Scott, who's making a comeback after taking the last episode off. How's it going, buddy?
Well, Royal Patrick, always happy to be on.
I am just personally interested to see what Kent Hughes can bring to the Canadiens going forward. And in my own personal opinion, I think it's time that we just look at this era as a fresh start and a chance for the Canadiens to rebuild and look to a hopefully better future. I don't really have any expectations for Hughes myself, as I'm not really too familiar with him. I know he's an NHL player agent, and I know he has a lot of really good experience that he brings to the table. But Montreal's at a point right now where they're dead last in the NHL. They're clearly in a rebuilding phase, and all they can do is look to the future and hope. And I think that the one thing that Kent Hughes can maybe give this team is a little bit of hope. He seems like a pretty smart guy, and it seems like he can make some solid trades to make the Canes a bit more competitive this season. And hey, maybe in the fire sale they have at the trade deadline, he can actually get some solid pieces for Ben Sherrod and many others. It remains to be seen.
And as a bald-headed man myself, I do admire his haircut. Sebastian, what's up, buddy? How's it going? So what's your take on Mr. Hughes?
You know, I'm liking it more and more, like the more I read about him and learn about him, because he was a very, I guess, unknown figure for most of the fan base, even just prior to today in the press conference, right? Because as he said himself in the press conference, he was the kind of agent that kind of just, he stayed in the background. He didn't like the spotlight. But what I'm liking a lot about him is that the press conference made it very clear that he has a very modern outlook on the game, which makes me very, very happy and relieved. But he's also an interesting hire because I think that him having that negotiating and agent background will be a very good complement to Jeff Gorton.
Then the sensation from Guelph, Mr. Joshua Rosa, what's your take on it, bud?
Yeah, I think having Jeff Gorton as the president and kind of their equals kind of tempers the argument about his greenness in NHL managing in general. I think this move is a bit of a course correct from what Mark Bergevin was doing, because listening to what Kent Hughes was saying during his press conference earlier was that he wants to focus on players' relationships, which was something that I feel that could have been done better in the Bergevin era when you look at things like how Markov's final deal was or non-deal was handled, or Perry last year. And you don't get fooled by the way they were celebrating with all the players down after that second last win there. I think he didn't have great relationships with the players, it seemed to me, from the outside looking in, and that seems like something that Kent Hughes brings experience in spades and could really help with this team getting new talent and keeping the talent that's here happy and here.
Let's talk a little bit about this tandem that has been instilled between Jeff Gordon and Kent Hughes. I strongly believe that this is going to be kind of a copy paste of what's going on in Vegas with George McPhee and Kelly McCrimmon, because I'm sorry, but like it's Gordon is going to probably going to have the last word on all trades, free agents, and everything. While you know, Hughes is going to take is going to focus more on the negotiation aspect of the game and also just managing the player personnel for that matter. However, that being said, how much leverage do you guys think that Gordon? And not Gordon, but Ken Hughes is going to have in making trades, in deciding who's going to be part of the roster, who's going to be deciding, you know, who's going to be the head coach, because obviously now, you know, is Dominique Deschamps going to be back next year? That's going to be another question. So, or is this going to be, like I said, George McPhee and Kelly McCrimmon, or back when Joe Sakic, you know, stepped back a little for a while with, I believe it was Sherman hit the GM at the time until he Sakic the job back and everything. So, I mean, who's the boss here?
I don't necessarily think it's about one being the boss over the other. I think how it's going to be going forward is it's just going to be a system where both of them have to compromise things, right? And find some consensus. And it's honestly the same process with which like the Montreal Canadiens chose Kent Hughes. It was an entire committee. It was not one person. It was not Molson going out and picking Kent Hughes. It was him with Gordon and advisors and whatnot, right? And I think that's also how it's going to be going forward. And there are going to be many discussions between Hughes and Gordon and finding a consensus and somebody that, like, for a coaching job, find someone that they both like a lot. Or when it comes to, like, free agent things, talking together. And then sometimes Gordon will have his way, other times Hughes will. But I don't really see this as, like, a lot of people are still saying that, like, oh, whoever the GM is going to be, so Hughes here is going to be like the puppet for Gordon being the puppet master. That's not really how I see it. I think it's more of a delegation of different responsibilities where Gordon will have most of the say on like the roster building, whereas Hughes will really spearhead the negotiations, the management of players, but also management of staff, because the Montreal Canadiens are a massive organization. There are a lot of people going around and working for the team that aren't on these. Managing them is also a huge part of it, and having two people to do that one job as GM now, I think it's a pretty good idea.
Well, that's the thing, isn't it? Because when you look at Marc Bergevin's tenure in Montreal, this is a man who had like 14 hats on. He was managing everything, including the Rocket on top of that, you know? So it's like it comes to say that after a while, yeah, it wears you out. And at the same time, it's a situation where you have someone at the helm of a franchise with, you know, $100 million payroll just for personnel itself. You know, he has to have at least some sort of qualification. And one of these qualifications is the fact that he actually has a university degree in sports management. You know, we were talking about this off the air. Like, you know, Ken Hughes is the first GM in Canadian history to have a university degree, you know, so it's already off the bat. You know, it's interesting, but there is one thing I want to dissect it, because you mentioned this, Sebastian, and I want to just put this out there with for everybody to discuss, because you said, oh, you know, they had a process with Jeff Molson, and then they're doing interviews and everything. I personally think that's a whole load of baloney. It's complete BS, because I'm sorry, but if really you spend the last couple of weeks interviewing people, okay, and we're talking about like 2 weeks, 3 weeks at the most, and Kent Hughes is your, you know, final decision after negotiating a contract and whatnot. This is a guy who's running his own agency, player agency. He is the agent of big time names like Patrice Bergeron and Christopher Letang, et cetera, et cetera. So you're telling me that this guy, you know, on a dime, decided, was like, yeah, okay, I'm going to let go of my agency. I'm going to, you know, forget about all my players and everything. And then all of a sudden, it's, you know, I'm going to become a GM of the Montreal Canadiens. I'm sorry, but it takes more than a couple of days in order to make that transition. My thought is he was picked at the very beginning of the process, was probably given like a month or like, you know, in order to get his affairs in order and to make a proper decision. And in the meantime, they interview people in the off chance that Hughes says no, in the end, I don't want the job, because otherwise it doesn't make it doesn't make any sense. I mean, on the logistical standpoint, at least.
In the actual press conference, Jeff Gorton was talking about this exact process and saying that, like, towards the very beginning of it, he approached Hughes and asked him to interview for the position. And that Hughes then took his time to think about, is this something I would feel comfortable, like, interviewing for and going for? And he decided that, yes, in the end, he would be comfortable doing it. And then he had his interview. So his interview, I believe Pierre LeBrun was the one that said this, but he was the last of the 11 candidates to have their first interview. And that was last Monday. Mm-hmm. And then basically the last week was Gorton and Molson and the committee deciding who their favorite was, right?
Well, my point exactly. I mean, he was advised way in advance, being like, you know, get your affairs order, because
I'm sure he wasn't the only one, though. I'm sure he wasn't the only one that was approached at the very beginning, right? Because in the end, they wanted to interview as many competent Quebecois hockey minds as possible. It's a fairly big field, but it's limited in the NHL, right? It's not like for other teams where they can hire whoever they want to, right? So I'm sure they sent out, like, invitations to everyone that was, like, up there, right? Like Briard, Luongo, whoever, right? Like Dash, all these pretty big names and people that they knew, because the hockey world is so connected that, like, they know all these people, right? Like Gorton and Hughes have known each other for 20 plus years. Makes sense that he'd approach him and be like, would you possibly be interested in interviewing for it? I don't think he'd be number one choice, because honestly, I don't think it makes any sense if you're trying to hire the best person for the job to have that kind of front runner going into it, because the whole interview process is to figure out what are their ideas for team building, what is their vision, and even if someone is like the front runner, like what if someone else's plan has more clarity and is more well thought out, right? Like I feel like what they said in the press conference was that they went in with no front runner in mind, right? Of course, it's not necessarily the truth, but I just think in terms of just making sense and trying to make the best hockey team possible and getting the best candidate, having a front runner isn't really the best way of doing that.
Well, I think that one of the main things to mention, though, is that at least with Hughes and Gorton as the 1-2 tandem of agent and player, I can say that the Canadians aren't in the worst managerial position in the NHL anymore, I find. I think there's teams out there that are a lot worse. And I think it's nice to finally be able to say that the Canadians are not the worst in something. I mean, you can look at the Seattle Kraken, which in my opinion are the worst run team in the NHL right now. Ron Francis absolutely shot that franchise in the foot with his over foot fixation on maintaining salary cap structure and stockpiling draft picks. And now the Kraken are where they belong, at the bottom of the Pacific. So I can definitely say that the Canadians finally are, oof, that's the tea. No, I can say this, that finally the Canadians are not the worst at something in the NHL. And I think the combination of Gorton as the negotiator of the trades and Hughes as negotiator of contracts could work really well. It remains to be seen.
Okay, let's get Josh into the conversation a little bit, because don't think I'm going to let you off the hook so easily, good sir. Now, I just want to, we all want to know your opinion, of course, on a few things. First of all, I mean, it is kind of cool. It's a homecoming for Hughes. I mean, he is from Montreal, and yes, he does speak French and everything. He played his minor hockey here and everything. He's got a lot of ties with the province, and he has got on record during the press conference that he has, and this has been confirmed, he has spoken to Bill Guérin, GM of the Wild, on his opinion. I mean, like, should I take this job? And he's like, dude, this is the Dallas Cowboys or the New York Yankees of hockey, and which is absolutely true. But that being said, though, I mean, you're taking over a storied franchise and everything. And one of the things that stood out the most to me was that he is a fan of advanced analytics, much to Sebastian's joy, and much to a lot
I
of
cried tears of joy,
I'm sure. And I couldn't care less personally. And I know Josh has a, you know, he's kind of iffy on the topic as well a little bit. So I'd like to know your opinion. I mean, like, what's going to happen after this kind of comment? Do you think the Canadians are going to be building, you know, a full committee based on these advanced analytics? Or should we be expecting maybe a different approach as to how we're going to be building this team from here on forth? Because, I mean, the bottom line is we are, you know, 29 years removed from our last Stanley Cup. So, I mean, we don't really care how they do it as long as they get there. So what do you think this approach is going to be with the new regime?
Well, first off, everyone loves a homecoming, whether it's such a storied franchise as Montreal with such a history with the French Canadian Yeah, someone from Seattle coming into the Seattle. Anything at home, it's your head. It holds your head up higher. You do better, basically. You want to do the best for your place of birth. But
unless your name is Vincent Le Cavalier, but whatever.
But there were a couple things that I was kind of maybe a little apprehensive of during his press conference when talking about his plan and vision for the team. I know there's the whole advanced analytics stuff, and I'm more into the I guess you could call them surface level statistics than the deeper analytical stuff. But there were things that he was saying about leadership character stuff, which I think is good and important to have. But I think that's something that team has kind of been mired in the past a little bit that has kind of brought them down. If you think of teams in the past, they're filled with all these smaller players that play with the biggest hearts in the world, but they don't get the production done necessarily. When you have David Desharnais as your first line center, sure, he's like a passionate guy and he plays hard and well all the time.
He does
have the talent to put the puck in the net, and that's where Montreal has been really short of in the last little while. You've got Gallagher, who plays like that, but was capable of putting in 30 goals this season. I don't know if he can do it anymore now. But what I really think we need high-end guys to complement those character leader guys. And it'll be interesting to see how they plan to bring those guys in, either through the draft, through free agency or trading. But that, I feel, should be the focus.
Scott, I want you to jump in on this. I mean, one of the things that's been mentioned was Hughes wants to build an offensive-minded and speedy team, which I cheered. I was like, yes! I'm tired of seeing the Habs play the trap for the last 60 years. But, I mean, how are we going to accomplish this with our current roster? I mean, like, do we need to blow it up and start over, or is this going to be like another quote unquote reset? I mean, what do you think is going to be the plan going forward?
Well, you can say that the Canadiens technically should have already had that speedy offensive minded team. The problem is that the speedy offensive minded players they have don't produce offensively. So that's the kind of struggle they've been dealing with. You can look at guys like Christian Dvorak. You can look at guys like Mike Hoffman, who were brought in to bring that speed and that offensive game. But for me personally, whenever Christian Dvorak scores a goal, it looks like the last place he wants to be is in Montreal. So I find that the Canadiens, I don't know if they need a full-on reset. I just feel like some pieces need to be obtained. They need to keep some pieces and get rid of other pieces that can kind of overall form a roster that, while speedy and offensive, can actually produce offensively. And I don't know whether guys like Hoffman will be in that future plans. I hope guys like Tyler Toffoli can remain like that for the future. But in my opinion, I think Montreal is really going to need to look to the one thing that they haven't been able to succeed with, the draft, to get what they ultimately want, which is that speedy, high-powered offensive team. I think a really good point to make is when you look at a guy like Cole Caulfield this season, who's brought a lot of speed and energy to the team, but he doesn't really have an impact. He's skating around the ice quickly, he's building energy, but that's really all he's doing. As my dad often said about Jacob Delarose, he basically saw him as just a big, beautiful racehorse. He could skate really well, and that's about all he could do. So I feel like Montreal's going to have to look to the draft if they want to be able to get some offense going in the future.
Sebastian, you want to jump in on that and maybe give us your take on what do you think needs to be done? Because I know I know what you're going to say, but I just want you to hear it.
Go ahead.
Yeah, go ahead. I mean, just say it.
I mean, yeah, I am in favor of a rebuild right now, considering, I mean, the team is dead last in the league when they were shooting for a playoff spot, right? Like, we are somehow have a worse record than the Arizona Coyotes, who have literally traded away every valuable piece except for Jacob Chychrun and Clayton Keller. There we go. They have two
players. And fill the thrill. Come on.
Well, my man just
the point I'm going to make, and the thing that I've written about before, is that the Coyotes literally have nothing. They struggle to pay taxes on their current arena, and they don't have an arena next season. So
It's complete opposites, considering they're basically the poorest franchise, and we are one of the richest, right? Like, it is a difference there. But But the impressive thing is that the Habs are somehow even worse this season than the Coyotes are, right? Like, that's like, we were literally shooting for a playoff spot. Like, yes, the team was decimated with COVID and injuries and whatnot, but like, how do you sink lower than Arizona? That is my question. And I think a rebuild is very important because the team is very much split in terms of age categories right now, right? Like, you have the Brendan Gallaghers, you have the Jeff Petries, the Carey Prices, and even if you stretch it to like the Toffolis and I don't know, like what, Anderson and obviously Savard and Sherratt, but you have like all these guys that are right around 30. Anderson's younger, but right around 30 for the rest of them. And then the real core are like players that are really 24 and younger. And when I see that and you see the record, how do you like rationalize trying to be competitive in like next year? Because like, what are you working with that? I'm very much in favor of a rebuild. And of course, hearing of analytics makes me very happy because again, I don't think it should be like a Bible that you follow, because just like any other method of evaluation, analytics are flawed, but it's another tool that you can add to your toolkit and have another thing to evaluate players on. And analytics are very useful in trying to find like diamonds in the rough. Like obviously Bergevin always had the moniker of bargain bin Bergie, but how many of his bargain bins actually worked out? With analytics, you can actually maybe find some good ones there and fill out a lineup. But the way to build a good team, like, yes, analytics help, but it's through the draft, get high-end players, like Scott was saying, and just get that high-octane offensive game that I think we all want for this team.
I think at the
same time... Well, you can look at the Moneyball approach that... Oh, sorry, Patrick, to interrupt really quick. You can look at the Moneyball approach that Billy Bean used when he was working with the Oakland Athletics and kind of applied it to hockey. But I feel like what you said, Sebastian, analytics have to go hand-in-hand with the natural aspects of hockey that we've grown up watching and learning about for decades. Because if you don't, you end up what the Florida Panthers had, where Vegas fleeced them for everything they owned. So I definitely think both need to go hand-in-hand.
Yeah, the only thing with your Moneyball approach, Scott, is that Billy Bean had like it was like a $60 million payroll, whereas the Yankees had one of it four times over. So that's not exactly...
Yep. The Coyotes should go for the
but Billy I understand. Bean. But I understand what you mean. However, I want to add on to what Sebastian said. Analytics can play a small role into, you know, I'll half admit it, into maybe getting better players. But this is where having a former... present agent, player agent, might actually help a little bit, because a lot of people would say, well, Bergie was a former player. Like, yeah, but he was a player from a bygone era. The locker room has changed dramatically from those days, and today, you know, the players think differently, they act differently and whatever. So I think maybe Hughes might be a better judge of character than Bergevin was, because he knows exactly what these players are thinking, maybe on a more personal level, which...
It's not a very high bar, though.
No, I know, but still, it's just like... It's because, like, we're trashing the Habs like crazy for their season, and rightfully so. But on paper, I mean, this is still a really good team on paper. I disagree all you want, Sebastian.
Because I completely... Patrick, I am in complete 100% agreement with you.
Paper, I'm willing to argue this.
On paper.
Yeah, okay. But let me talk to you.
Just one second, Scott, and I'll let you in. I just really want to finish my thought, because Sebastian right now, I'm sorry, dude, but like, you get yourself checked for Alzheimer's, because I remember a few months ago, we were starting this season and all of us were like, oh yeah, Habs, lock in for the playoffs. You know, and we have a former teammate of ours who made fun of us because he was the only one being like, oh no, they're going to tank and they're going to suck at everything. Well, we're all eating our hats today because, yeah, he was right. That the team didn't make it.
I was saying borderline.
I know, but you still said they were going to make playoffs.
For sure.
We still...
Again, big differences also happened between then and the start of the season, right?
Yeah, like, a lot.
Carey Price, yeah. Edmondson, all that happened, right? But like...
But again,
my issue is like, is it though? Is it, or is it that the Montreal market always overvalues their own players, right? Like,
I think that's every market. Let's be honest.
Especially every Montreal, big markets, right? Like big markets like Montreal. But like, look, the team that was in the playoffs last season, would you call that a great team, or would you call that a team that got very hot at the right moment?
I call that any other, right? I call that any other Cinderella team that we've seen in the Stanley Cup playoffs.
They shouldn't have made the playoffs.
Regular 82 game schedule, they wouldn't be in the playoffs.
No, well, and the other thing you have to mention is that the Habs got the same lucky breaks any playoff team got. Where would they have been?
I'm not at all discounting the run. I'm just trying to show that from the team that made that run compared to the team that started this season, right?
Oh, yeah, totally.
Looking at that progression. Thomas Tatar, Mike Hoffman, that's a huge downgrade. Deneau and KK for Dvorak, that's a huge downgrade, right? All these things, downgrades. And, you know, like...
But yes, you didn't call it a downgrade when the trade was made. You were all happy that we got Dvorak.
No, I wasn't. I never liked that.
I guess hindsight's 50-50, Patrick.
Nope. I know, right?
Patrick, go back and listen to my commentary on that trade.
I mean,
I was not a fan.
I was excited about Dvorak. I didn't hate it.
I know. I'm joshing you, Sebastian. I totally get it.
I want Thomas Hurdle. Hurdle's been great.
You know who wasn't excited about it? Dvorak. That's the exact player.
He doesn't get excited about anything. Have you ever seen his face in any picture ever?
The issue that the Canes have is that Christian Dvorak is one of the few players who spent multiple years in the Arizona Coyotes organization. And if you want to know one thing about the Coyotes organization, the players live in complete unknown solitude. Like the media doesn't care about them. Nobody in the city cares about them. And now he comes to Montreal where everybody cares about every single player on this team. So it's a big leap for a guy like that, and a leap he probably didn't want to make. But I'm going to go back to what I was talking about the Habs being good on paper, and the fact that Montreal media really likes to paint a lot of excuses with this team as to try and explain why they've sucked this year. And for a while, we had that excuse when they were decimated by COVID and guys like Raphael Harvey-Pinard, Cameron Hillis, Brandon Baddock found themselves onto the lineup somehow. And you can make that excuse at that time, but now the Canadiens are healthy again, so that excuse doesn't apply anymore. And as I said in some less than ideal Twitter arguments, what the Habs really need right now is wins, not excuses. So you can make all the excuses you want about them being a good team on paper. And in my opinion, they are, but they just haven't been owning up to the task because guys have off seasons sometimes. I mean, just look at Philip Grubauer with the Kraken this season.
Let's talk about the media a little bit, and I'm going to get Josh out of his dark corner there and get his opinion on this as well. I mean, the media throughout this whole process has been extremely strange in, you know, digging up information and getting their own opinions for that matter, because I mean, for a franchise that has like 679 people sticking a microphone up one player's nostril at the end of every game, we're sure short on, you know, original opinion. And where I'm going with this is that when you're hearing stories about who the candidates were going to be, what the process is going to be, the commentary and everything, who do we hear it from? Pierre Lebrun, Bob McKenzie, Eric Engels, Elliot Freeman, and Connor McKenna, Dan Robertson. And then we would get, Priyanta Emrith retweeting everyone's tweet and, you know, making herself look legit. But then local media, I went there. Local media are like, he needs to speak French. And his last name needs to be like Tremblay or something. You know, so then when the press conference happened and we introduced Kent Hughes, the comments that we're getting, not just from the fans, but from the media itself, is like, oh, he has an accent. What is this? My ears. His last name is Anglo. My ears. What is this? So like, where are we heading? You know, like, what is going on? Not just with, the fan base has always been out of whack when it comes to culture and just it's a fact of Quebec and everything. But Josh, I mean, why is all the sources coming from Toronto? And it's not even coming from Montreal as a whole. I mean, like from the outside looking into this kind of fishbowl, since you're an Ontario native yourself, I mean, like, how do you perceive this? And it makes sense that, you know, Toronto talks about Toronto, Edmonton talks about Edmonton, but then when it comes to Montreal, it's just retweeting what others are talking about.
Well, as someone in Ontario that isn't part of the big cultural background that Quebec has and the Montreal Canadiens have, to me, on the outside looking in, and I understand that it's not that case for many people in the organization in Quebec itself and in hockey, is that it seems like a sort of vestigial idea about identity and nationality that can kind of be left in the past, in my opinion. Like, it is always nice, as I said before, to have the hometown guys in, and you always want to bring them in.
Absolutely.
But it comes, yeah, but it comes to a point where you want to have, the point of the game is to win the Stanley Cup. You want to give yourself best choice of doing that, and is forcing yourself to have a francophone general manager, francophone like any of this, dual language coach, is that the best way to go about this if your end goal is to win?
I mean, I'm not
from
hating,
the outside,
I'm not hating on my own province or my own culture for that matter, but I mean, if you're stuck on a desert island and you got two guys in front of you, and you have to pick one of these guys to lead your team to the promised land, and it's Kent Hughes or Lou Lamoriello, are you going to pick Ken Hughes because he speaks French?
Exactly. That's like, I could see it from way back when it's the whole Quebec versus Ontario, Francophones versus Anglophones. Yeah, that whole thing, totally. The whole Richard riots and things like that totally makes sense to me. But in a world today where we're all much more connected with each other, there isn't that big violent rivalry between the two people. We're just Canadians at this point. It seems like a relic of the past that could, like, not cut off completely, but
oh, absolutely,
be more lenient. No, of course.
Totally. Let's be honest here. Like, rivalries are a thing made for fans and the media, because I mean, I'm sorry, but like, there is no Montreal Toronto rivalry with the players, or a Montreal Boston rivalry with the players. You know, the thing is dead. You know, but yeah, I'll admit, you know, if the Canadians make a trade and they all of a sudden they get, you know, I don't know, Jonathan Huberdeau, oh yeah, of course I'd be excited. Not only is he an amazing player, but yeah, okay, you know, he's representing, you know, our province and everything. Like, yeah, I'd be excited, but would you take him, you know, again, over someone else who's a better player and just pick over language? But then that's a whole other story altogether, right?
The thing is that, again, it points to that issue of representing, Patrick. That's the issue that I think a lot of French media has, that going back to what Josh said about the Richard riot, a lot of French media still thinks the Canadians mean that much to the city. They don't, sadly, anymore. The Canadians aren't, they're just a hockey
team, the same thing
nowadays, and they aren't that big cultural emblem that used to be for the city.
Your generation, I mean, you guys are all younger than I am, and your generation grew up on Saku Koivu, basically.
And Eric Cole.
And Eric Cole and Michael Ryder. And yeah. And okay.
Glenn Metropolitan and every other favorite mid 2010s house player.
Exactly. You know, it's like, oh, you guys did, like, okay, none of us have seen, you know, the Richard Lafleur's Cournoyers, Bellevaux of this world and everything. But like, I still grew up and saw Patrick Roy. You know, and I've seen Vincent Danfous and Pierre Turgeon and Eric Desjardins, and it's like, wow, that was epic, you know. But you never had a team that was exciting enough in order to make it matter. But again, in today's world of globalization, your last name shouldn't matter, right? It's just that it's a matter of
getting, if you want a better example of how far the Canadians have come from being that great team, I remember walking through a flea market in Montreal and seeing posters of Guy Lafleur in one shop, and then I turned the next corner and there's a poster of Andreas Dackel and Joe Juno with the same font and the same Canadians marketing. So you can talk about how much the Canadians have changed and what their standard for a great player and a great emblem for
it's
the city is. And I think it's been weakened.
Yeah, exactly. But then I just one last thing. And Scott, I'm actually going to use you as an example. I mean, you're from here. Your family is from here. Your father is a very respected reporter for the Montreal Gazette. Your last name is Cowan. There is nothing Francophone or Quebecer about the name Cowan, you know? And I mean, you survive on a daily basis, right? I mean, you don't have any tomatoes thrown at you, right?
Yeah, I get by. I get by as best I can. And even especially in the media, I get by as best I can.
Exactly. So, I mean, it shouldn't matter for that matter. But anyways, that being said, let's go from one Frenchie to another. And Sebastian, I want you to be all over this, because this is something that I know, again, it kind of ties in a little bit with the advanced analytics and the idea of having a speedy offensive-minded, puck possession-minded team. And we need to address the elephant in the room, and that's going to be Dominique Duchamp. I'm of the opinion that he's going to finish the season. Is he going to come back, though? Like, is Kent Hughes actually going to hang on to him and being like, well, you know, we're already playing Claude Julien's contract, you know, for another year. And are we going to be paying Duchamp's contract for the next, was it 2 or 3 years or something? Or are they going to turn around and play some else? Julien's expires after the season, I believe. Yeah,
exactly. So I'm almost positive that Duchamp is going to be the coach for the season, right? Like, I don't, there's no point in changing that. Moltz is not paying three coaches. That's just not going to happen. But it's going to be interesting. So during the presser, of course, Kent Hughes was asked about the coaching situation, and basically what he said was like, Duchamp's our coach for now, right? Like, it was all very fluid and like, get a sense that there's a good possibility that he might want to pick his own guy. Like, he was like asked like very straightforwardly, like, do you want to just pick your own coach? And he was like, not necessarily, right? But the whole sense of it was like, he might want to have some change, especially considering that, okay, as you guys were saying, the Habs roster on paper, like, I don't think it's good, but it should be a whole lot better than what's been this season. Even considering injuries and COVID and whatever, it needs a better record than what they have, right? I think that's what, like, no one can refute that, really. And Duchamp's systems have been, again, like when he came in, everyone was like, oh, this progressive coach, because in juniors, he was played a progressive style, and I was all excited. But that's not really how it's translated to the NHL. Like, we still see the trap all game, every game. The power play has been atrocious because it relies on point shots. Point shots have been extinct basically in the NHL as a power play weapon for like, what, 5-6 years? Why is that the primary thing now? It shouldn't be. And still, you always see Jeff Petrie and Ben Chiarot shooting. The only defenseman that doesn't do it is Chris Weidman, because he doesn't have a very good shot. So of course he's not going to shoot from the blue line, but like, it's just, those elements are frustrating. So I can see why Kent Hughes want to have his own coaching staff and like maybe like not clean house with coaches, but maybe like put Burrows back in the AHL and fire Duchamp, get his own head coach, get an assistant coach in there, maybe keep Luke Richardson. I don't know, but I think that's most likely. And as a fan,
take a look at Jean-Francois Houle.
Yeah, okay. It's an option.
Okay, right? Well, tell you what, guys, we're gonna take a little break from that topic. We're going to move on to Josh and his little history lessons, and we're going to come back at the end of the show, and we're all going to make a little nomination as to who we think should be the next Canadiens coach. How does that sound?
It's a good question.
It's going to give you some time to think about it. So we're going to send it right over to Joshua Rosa. Professor, are you ready for our history lesson this week?
Let's roll.
Let's rock and roll. Oh, sorry. Let's puck and roll, my friends. Fire away, good sir.
On this day, January 19th, the year of our Lord, 1901, Dunk Munro was born in Moray, Scotland. Having moved to Canada young, he was a defender and captain of Canada's 1924 Olympic team. Team Canada steamrolled the competition, outscoring them 100-3 on the way to winning the gold medal. In 1928, Munro's Montreal Maroons won the Stanley Cup, and he was the first European-born player to ever win Lord Stanley's mug. Next year, Munro suffered a heart attack, and while recovering, came down with pneumonia, and the Maroons plummeted to the bottom of the standings. But he returned the next season, became their head coach as well as their captain, and they rocketed right back up to the top of the league. And he played 7 more years in the league, and his last NHL season was with the Montreal Canadiens. Other Montreal alumni born on January 19th is 7th overall pick Mike Komisarek in 1982, and one-year wonder in Montreal, and highest drafted Austrian player in NHL history at fifth overall in 2003, Tom Manek was born in 1984. And a special birthday to a player that's never played a game for Montreal, but everyone should remember his name from last week. It's Larry Goodenough. The Flyers legend, owner of a great name and hairdo, was born on January 19th, 1953. All right. So, last week, I heard all your outrageous outcries of outrage outlining our befuddling lack of Lafleur or Rocket Richard facts. Well, your prayers have been thankfully answered today.
Hallelujah!
In Lafleur's illustrious career, he played 8 games on January 19th, 7 with the Habs and 1 with the New York Rangers. The teams went 5-2-1, and he recorded 2 goals and 5 assists on that day. He fared better on January 20th games, playing just 5 games with 3 wins and 2 losses with 6 goals and 4 assists. Maurice Richard, however, played 6 games on both January 19th and 20th, and both because he scored 5 goals and 3 assists, but did have 1 fight in a game against Boston in 1946. Well, I hear you ask, what about Montreal as a whole? Well, I have those stats here. The Habs have played 41 January 19th games, unfortunately finishing with a mediocre 16 wins, 8 ties, and 17 losses. Their worst loss was against the Boston Bruins in 1974, 8-0. But they beat the Maple Leafs in 1980, 7-2. Interestingly enough, in every single January 19th game, Montreal scored 105 combined goals and was scored on exactly 105 times for a perfect even goal differential. And finally, with the utmost pleasure possible, born right here in Guelph, Ontario, Canada, on January 20th, 1932, was Leapin' Lou Fontanato. The pride of Royal City was the first player to earn 200 penalty minutes in a single season, and split time between the Rangers and the Habs. His career ended on a missed hit that paralyzed him for over a month. But after his NHL career, he became a sheep farmer with a farm on the exact road that I am recording this podcast from. Obviously, I'm not recording on the road. I've been recording in a house on the road, but
that's shocking.
It's this road. Yeah. He moved over to a cattle farm in Eden Mills, and sadly passed away in 2016 here in Guelph.
Well, there's your proof, ladies and gentlemen. There is internet connection at the Rosa farmhouse. Thanks a lot, Josh. That was awesome as always.
Hello, my name is Mr. Snrub, and I come from someplace far away. Yes, that will do.
We're going to take a little break from Habs talk for a few seconds, send it over to Scott Cowan, who excitedly wants to talk about the ECHL All-Star game, and especially with one particular player who ended the game with, what was it, 5 assists, man?
5 assists indeed. My man, Olivier Archambault, finally got his recognition after a pretty difficult year last year for Archambault. I mean, I've talked about him before a bit on this podcast, and I find his connection to the Canadiens interesting. People always discuss him when they talk about failed Quebec draft picks for the Canadiens. He was a fourth-round pick of the team in 2011, and he's bounced around the AHL and the ECHL since then, and he kind of just came full circle and found us about to travel to the air, and he's flourished. He has 26 points in 22 games. He's been a very solid player, and he's been exactly the type of person to put fans in their seats that the Lyon needed. And when the Lyon signed him, I thought that's the exact kind of player he would be, and he's the exact player he has been. In general, the ECHL this season has just had a nice return to what made the league so much fun to watch all those years back, which is star players. As much as most people aren't really aware, the ECHL in the cities that it has its teams have pretty devoted fan bases, and if they have players who can put the fans in the seats, it's all the more interesting. A guy I wanted to make a point about who isn't Olivier Archambault really quickly is Chad Costa. Costello. A lot of people aren't really going to be familiar with this name at all, but Costello put up seasons of 125, 103, and 122 points in his past three seasons in the ECHL and looks to be a solid player this year as well at the Island Americans. So I just think it's nice to see the ECHL returning back to the star players that it was used to instead of finding that perfect blend between being a development league and being a proper league for these veteran guys looking to play for the level of hockey. So if guys like Archambault get the opportunities, I think it's going to be interesting to see, especially where the Lyon go going forward, because they've been just a ton of fun to watch this year.
Absolutely. I mean, this is the cool. I think this is also like one of the rippling effects of the Trois-Rivières-Lyon at the same time, is the fact that we have a lot more access now to this level of hockey, and it's not disappointing. I mean, if anybody has taken the time to actually watch an ECHL game, it ain't that bad. Honestly, it's not. It's a far cry from what was it, the North American Hockey League. I don't know if that's still around, where you have a fight every 6 seconds, right?
or the WHA2 or the LNAH or the UHL, whichever old minor hockey league you want to talk about.
Exactly. Anything that inspired the movie Goon, right? So,
well, I think a great point to make as well, just really quickly, Patrick, is that people look at the Laval Rocket this year, and the Laval Rocket are fighting for a playoff spot. Why do you think that is? Because they have a host of guys to select from the 12 of the early on. So the ECHL plays a role in development for guys, so can't really forget about it.
Exactly. And it's gotten us some great stories, like our man RHB, you know, who made a great debut for the Habs when he was called up. And also, it's one of the positives of COVID. We got to meet the greatest flow in the modern flow in the NHL, and Michael Pezzetta. I'm a fan. I mean,
I've absolutely fallen in love with Pezzetta this season. I think he's everything and more that this team should be. And he brings the energy that so many other guys haven't brought. Also, scoring a goal off your face, you just can't beat that.
Exactly. Let's go. In your face, sucker. Sebastian, you have some updates on this current crop of prospects that you would like to present to us before we go back to the burning coaching questions of that we were talking about earlier.
Yeah, I mean, there's always a player that I can just talk about that I feel like I haven't talked about enough.
For 45 minutes?
No, just 43. But I think one player that that's really slowly really growing on me, that is like one of like the top prospects in the draft, is Frank Nazar. This is a player who plays for the U.S. National Development Program, and he is electric. He is a bit undersized. He can play both center and wing. Almost every game I've watched, he has been playing at center, and he looks pretty good doing it. He really is like a bulldog. Like he has such a great motor, and he always goes to the middle of the ice in the offensive zone. And I love that. You see so many like undersized players, or just like any players in general, that just stick to the perimeter way too much in the offensive zone. Like it's my main criticism of Riley Kidney, and why I'm a bit like lukewarm on him as a prospect, is because he does almost all of his like playmaking from the perimeter. Not Frank Nazar. He always goes to the net every single time, to the point where like he could almost go to the perimeter a bit more, just to like change things up a bit. But he's been really fun, and his offensive ceiling I think is even higher than Logan Cooley's, which is already a really high ceiling. Like Logan Cooley is so much fun. And 2 days ago on Monday was the BioSteel game, which is basically this game for USHL prospects of just like the best of the best playing each other. And usually it's like the best like US NTDP players versus the best of the rest. And then the US NTDP wins that game every year. This year, they actually mixed up the teams. So you had like US NTDP players on both sides. And it was really fun to watch. I watched instead of the Arizona game, which I think was a very good choice considering how bad that game ended up being. And Frank Nazar was solid. Cooley stole the show in that game. He was exceptional. And I was very impressed with some other players, like Lane Hudson is growing on me. But back to Nazar, undersized, high offensive ceiling. He has a nice shot. His playmaking is good. Always brings the puck to the center of the ice. And, you know, I think I have him at like 6 right now. I could see him jumping up to like 5, maybe even 4 by the end of the year. Because, again, I love high ceiling players. And more than anything, he's fun to watch. And as we've been saying, but the Habs, we want a fun, offensive, fast, skilled team. Nazar is that. Like, you point at that, and it's like, that's the guy. He is all of those things. He's fun. And this draft is a really good one for that, right? Like, Shane Wright isn't quick, but he's very good. And then you have players like Nazar, Cooley, and Brad Lambert that are fun, skilled, fast, exciting. And I'm just
looking forward to Brad Lambert is one of my personal favorite prospects.
Oh, I have him at two because I love the guy. He's amazing. But there's so many options that the Habs can end up with that would just be fun, right? Like, actually just exciting. Like, I like Kotkaniemi. Was he electrifying ever with the Habs? No, not really, right? They're never a needle mover. And even, like, on the defensive side of things, like Simon Nemets and David Jiříček, these are fun players. And the Habs are going to get a fun player in all likelihood, and that has me very excited for draft day.
And I'll make one point about Brad Lambert that I continually make with prospects, men's league. It's absolutely essential for development, and it can help guys really improve.
Yeah, we were mentioning that last episode, exactly, about the effect of playing in the men's league. It's a huge difference, exactly. All right, gentlemen, thank you so much for this prospect update. And now, it's time for the burning question of the day. We're talking, of course, about Kent Hughes, which, you know, we dissected everything that needed to be dissected, and now we got into the coaching of the Canadians. And I think, you know, unless there's an absolute vote of confidence and they decide to keep Ducharme, or Jeff Molson decides, no, I'm tired of paying for coaches to sit at home and collect paychecks and do nothing with the art of the days, let's predict who will be the next Canadians head coach. I am going to start with any volunteers, or should I just pick someone? Josh, you go first.
Well, there's a couple of interesting guys. Like, could you imagine if Patrick Waugh pick? No, I would not go with either of them.
Well, what did we say? Before you continue, remember what we said? I think it was like 3 or 4 episodes ago. A dream combination would be having like Patrick Waugh as GM, and then Bob Hartley as head coach, or vice versa, and like it would just be the most entertaining thing ever.
Yeah, those two would be my pick for entertaining. If I wanted to pick who could be, I'd look to some articles. I don't remember specifically where they were coming from, but they were a lot of talk about hiring the people that they've interviewed for the GM in other places around the organization, different roles. So I think, looking at it, maybe if he would take the role, if Danny Briere could be a possibility. As I mean, he's never coached anything anywhere, but he was near the top of the list for the general manager. He's a very good player when he was in the NHL, almost played 1,000 games, scored like 114 points in like 124 playoff games. And I think he could know what the room should look like in an NHL team, because I think it's pretty clear that Dominic Ducharme has lost room. There's kind of no going back at this point, it seems. Looking at the defensive structure, they've just been awful.
Yeah, it's an absolute mess. But if I could just interject real quick, Josh, the only issue with having Briere as head coach is that in Montreal, in its current structure, in its current situation, not going to happen. They're not going to hire someone who has zero coaching experience. And also, Briere, if he's not coming to Montreal in any capacity whatsoever, either as assistant GM or head of player development or something, he's just going to stick around with Philadelphia, and he's going to become their next GM at some point, because all he's been doing for the longest time was shadowing Paul Holmgren in the president role. He was going through all the different levels of management. And I encourage everyone to visit the fourth period and read the article that our crewmate Anthony DeMarco wrote on that. And he was actually explaining with his interview with Beria that, yeah, like, he has this passion for management. So not to put the sad trombone in your court, Josh, but not gonna happen.
Oh yeah. Yeah, it's a That's an interesting thought.
But it's an interesting thought. I agree.
Yeah, none of the other guys really grab me out, like grab me by the throat and say, "Let's hire him." Like Patrick Law would be just be entertainment value. Same with John Tortorella, just to hear what he would say to the Montreal media.
Oh my goodness, that would be so epic!
Forget the media. Talk about the players. My God. Oh,
oh man, it'd be amazing.
He'd wipe that non-amused grin right off Christian Dvorak's face. He'd make him enjoy playing here in Montreal.
Just imagine
if him. I could throw in my opinion, though, really quick, Patrick. There are actually two guys that I think the Habs could look at, honestly. And obviously, I think the main league the Habs are going to be looking at for a head coach is the QMJHL. And the two coaches I think are the most interesting are, I'm going to butcher this name, is Serge Beausoleil and Yannick Jean, who are both guys who have been coaching the league for 10-plus years. Actually, Yannick Jean has been coaching for closer to 15 years. And they've led some teams to some QMJHL championships. They've led some playoff teams, and they seem like solid guys. My wild card pick for the head coach of the Canadiens is one of my favorite head coaches in the QMJHL, Gordy Dwyer, who used to be an enforcer with the Canadiens and has been all over the map when it comes to head coaching. He's coached in the Swiss A League. He's coached in the KHL. He's coached in the QMJHL. And while, obviously, as an Anglophone, it's highly unlikely he makes the team, he's just an interesting kind of wild card to throw out there as just a possible candidate.
Yeah, we totally do. Sebastian, I'm going to go with my picks, and then you can have the last word. Is that cool?
Of course.
All right. I actually dipped into the queue as well, except he ended up being kind of like fourth on my list because I got three names in front of me right now. That fourth candidate was Louis Robitaille, the head coach of the Gatineau Olympics. He's often been referred to as the next best thing, you know, or this guy has it. So to speak, when it comes to motivating his players. And I think he's doing a bang-up job with Gatineau on all aspects of the game. And it's also kind of interesting that we were talking about the North American Hockey League earlier, Scott, that Robitaille actually made a career out of having 300-plus penalty minutes as well. So he's probably good friends with Gordy Dwyer, for that matter. I think in the short term, if you're going with a full-scale rebuild and you still want to get someone with a little bit of experience, I would not be surprised if the Habs turn around and hire Guy Boucher as the next head coach. I know that it kind of gets into the way of the idea of offensive-minded and puck possession and whatnot, considering Boucher is an extremely defensive-minded coach, as you know, we all still remember those non-attacks that when he was with Tampa Bay, and I think it was against Philly or something, where there were five in the zone and no one was touching the puck, zero forecheckers. However, the two guys that kind of stand out to me the most as a potential candidate, the first one being Pascal Vincent, who is currently the assistant coach with the Columbus Blue Jackets. He was assistant coach for 5 years with the Winnipeg Jets. He was head coach of the Manitoba Moose as well for 5 years, although, you know, he didn't make the playoffs out of three of those years, but he still had, you know, above 500 win percentage, and he had a very solid career as well in the queue with the Cape Breton Screaming Eagles and the Montreal Juniors at the time. And I think he might actually fit the mold almost too perfectly, but again, it's a matter of like if he has the confidence. If not, another rookie coach, so to speak, that still has tons of experience. And Sebastian, you might actually enjoy this name because he's actually a Clarkson University alumni. We're talking about the current Laval Rocket head coach, Jean-François Hull, who like Scott said it earlier, is doing, you know, Laval is doing, you know, great this year, fighting for a playoff spot, Underwood and whatnot. And, you know, this is a guy who's been around, you know, like was assistant in Bakersfield. He was a head coach in Blainville in the queue in the Louis the Maniacs. You know, definitely has that modern approach to the game. So I think it'll probably go down between either Vincent or Ulb, or I'm hoping I'm wrong, but I mean, like, I just sincerely hope they're not going to go back the recycling route and hire Alain Vigneault or something, because then, you know, then you know, because I mean, we went through Terrien and we went through
round three, let's go.
So then we already saw that. Might as well bring back Vigneault to finish that trifecta, right?
But, see, Patrick, if you want to bring throw a name into the hat to bring back in, what about a guy like Joe Bouchard? Even
you have to leave someone for me. I need someone in the main that I can throw in. That's a guys. Like, I had Boucher, I had Bouchard. Like, come on, I need somebody here that has coaching experience.
I do agree with Bouchard. You're leaving me with
like Marc Denis, who has zero coaching experience. Like, come on, guys.
We could always bring back Mario Tremblay. There.
Okay, no. Staying with the Tremblays.
Why don't we just bring back
my
Jean
far
Paul,
best option? Oh, Réjean.
Oh, we
bring in Réjean Tremblay.
Réjean Tremblay. Oh man, the most bitter journalist in the history of everything.
That'd be really funny.
That'd be hilarious, though. But okay, so Sebastian, for whoever's left on your list,
I don't have a list anymore. I'm trying to think of names here.
Who did you have on your list originally?
Okay, I had Joël Bouchard as head coach. I think that he could be enticed to return to Montreal, considering that obviously he'd have the top head coaching job, which is huge, right? And it's also that, like, it's a clean slate in terms of who's managing him, right? Like, mm-hmm. I think things got bitter between him and Bergevin. Depends on if he had any, like, bitterness left with Molson, but who knows? And I think that Guy Boucher would be a phenomenal hire as an assistant coach. I think that if you get his defensive systems in, because he, like every time you listen to him talk hockey, he's a brilliant hockey mind, right? Like,
he
really is. Yeah. Bring him either as an assistant coach or consultant or something. I would love to have him in the organization. I don't know about head coaching, but I think that, like, Joël Bouchard as a head coach, and then you have Luke Richardson, some other person that knows how to offense, right? Unlike Richardson or Boucher, and have Boucher as a third assistant coach. I think that'd be a pretty nice coaching setup. But yeah, like, again, there are quite a few options, but the Quebec buff factor limits it a little bit. So you guys really said most of the names.
Well, I think the issue that you also throw caution to the wind with Joel Bouchard is that he was signed to be the San Diego Gulls head coach because Dallas Eakins was on shaky grounds in Anaheim. And now Dallas Eakins is leading Anaheim to the playoffs. So Joel Bouchard's future with Anaheim as a coach seems kind of wary. And also, he hasn't had a great season with the San Diego Gulls to begin with. So while I don't think it's an automatic, I think he would be more open than most people would think to coming back to Montreal, especially if things don't work out in Anaheim.
Exactly.
What if, again, we're going to end with a what if. What if the Canadians decide, you know what, you know, we got our bilingual guy in order to represent the team in Kent Hughes, you know, for the French side and everything. What if we actually turned around and we hired an Anglophone coach? Who would be the best candidate in this case? Do you dare go down the John Tortorella route? Do you get someone like Rick Tocchet? Maybe do you start, you know, looking around and seeing, you know, what's out there, what's left out there that might actually be enticing? Let's say, you know, or do you actually decide to give Mike Babcock another chance at a job and you bring him in? I mean, like, is there anybody that's actually perfect for this job?
You just made me run over my foot there, Patrick. I will. If Mike Babcock ever finds his way back to an NHL bench, that's the day I quit being a sports journalist. Mike Babcock should never be allowed to another NHL bench. In my own opinion, any coach who can make Mitch Marner cry should not be allowed near another NHL bench. In my own opinion,
that makes me happy though. But anyways, Josh, like, do you, top of your head? I mean, is there anybody that actually stands out? And being like, you know, language be damned. Like, this guy should be our next coach.
The only real name that I could really think about that we haven't talked about would be someone like Gallant coming in. I think maybe it could be prudent if we're talking about long, painful rebuild, can we just keep Ducharmin for however many, 2-3 years in his contract and let him tank the team and then get the best guy that gets fired coming 2 years? Because, none of the names truly stand out as we should really get this guy unless, like we've mentioned, Bouchard would be really the perfect fit. But yeah, there's not really anything that stands out to me directly as a rebuilding team.
I mean, top of my head, the only guy who'd actually make sense aside from a Daryl Sutter, which would be, you know, absolutely incredible, because it's exactly what the city would need, would be like a Daryl Sutter type no nonsense coach, is David Quinn, who was head coach under Jeff Gordon in New York. You know, so it's like, and again, Quinn was a victim of a very flawed dressing room, you know, that was split in half with the likes of Artemi Panarin and Tony D'Angelo, you know, with his open with political statements and everything. And then when Chris Drury was hired as general manager, well, the first thing he did was like, ah, I want my own coach. And then he got fired, and the rest is history. But Sebastian, I mean, I saw you nod at Sutter, shake your head at Quinn. I mean, I'm guessing you have an opinion.
I mean, Quinn, I don't know. Like, I just didn't like what he was doing in New York. Whereas Sutter, it's such a funny coach, because he is this extremely traditional coach, right? Like, but analytically, he is one of like the best coaches in the league. Like, whatever team he gets in charge of, the analytics skyrocket. Like, just like absolute spike, right?
So he's a genius.
An interesting. Yeah. He's really good in just getting the most out of his players, which is why I like him. My like super out there, I guess, idea, again, head coaches wouldn't make sense. It would have to be the assistant job first, but I would look at trying to bring in someone like Jack Hahn. Are you guys familiar with Jack Hahn? He was the assistant coach for the Toronto Marlies for quite a few years. And since then, he's basically just been like freelancing and doing his own thing, despite having contract offers to be with AHL or even NHL teams. And he's from Montreal. So this is someone who he was with the Habs in like a social media capacity in like 2010. And so he knows the organization. He'd be a really interesting one, because he is like this like extremely tactical coach. Like he publishes books on hockey tactics, right? Like his thing is tactics and reading play. He would be a very interesting person to bring in. I think head coach would be a real stretch, because he's in his 20s and he has no NHL coaching experience. So that would be a real stretch. However,
well, Hahn would be perfect. Maybe like in player development, because wasn't he
involved. He was involved in it. So what I would bring him in.
Also McGill alumni. That's cool.
A McGill alumni too. What I would bring him in as would be like the head coach for development, right? Of like, he is the person that watches all the tape of all the Habs prospects and gives them insight and coaches them that way. Yeah. No matter the coaching quality of their respective junior teams or European teams or whatnot, they're getting feedback from one centralized person. I think that would be a really interesting role for that kind of person. And that way, you might also be grooming him for a head coaching role in the future. He's from Montreal. He can speak French. I think that would be a win-win-win. But I don't know. It also goes straight into like my philosophy of a more modern game and stuff, right? So of course you're laughing at that, which is totally fair. But
I can totally understand where you're coming from, Sebastian. I think Jack Hahn also brings that youthfulness to the coaching development that can also be great for the players to relate to. I think a lot of people point to the fact of why college coaches don't work in the NFL, making a quick football reference, and the fact is that you can't yell at a college player the way you yell at a professional football player, because they'll tell you to basically go to hell. So I think Hahn can definitely bring that youthfulness to development, which can help.
I think the only thing that, oh man, you know what, guys, we're talking about Daryl Sutter, we're talking about Hahn, we're talking about language. There's only one perfect candidate, and you're all going to hate me for this, and everyone listening is going to hate me for this, because he fits all of those bills, you know, one after the other.
I mean, and it's hate it, it's just, it will go right back into the recycling bin, like, again.
And it's not Patrick Waugh, by the way. Nor is it Alain Vigneault. It's Bob Hartley.
What? Believe no, I thought you were going Claude Julien here.
Okay. No, I'm not going Julien.
What? You're
not going
Bob Hartley?
Bob Hartley. I despise him. But the fact of the matter is, because on a short-term basis, when you're trying to bring like, just bring the spark back, so to speak, he's absolutely brilliant. Look what he did in Calgary. He came in for those, 2 years or something, and the team was totally turned around until they, you know, moved on and they had, you know, the whole fiasco before they landed with
them. Give me Guy Boucher on a short-term thing rather than Bob Hartley.
But Hartley...
I have another point to... You know what? I'm going to step in and offer one more for you, Patrick. Bob Hartley was the only coach that ever made the Atlanta Thrashers a competitive hockey team. So you can also point to that when you talk about how good he was.
There you go.
Took a team that literally had nothing, and he made them into a winner, albeit very briefly, but...
If he can keep his emotions in check, which is something Juan cannot do, he might actually have another shot at being head coach in the NHL again via Montreal. I mean, this is a team that lacks character. This is a team that needs direction, and maybe having like someone that still has the fire for the game in Hartley, it might work. I hate the idea, but it's almost too logical. But then again, I think we're going back to the argument earlier that the team is good on paper. So maybe Hartley was good on paper, but then it's just not going to work. Right. I mean, okay, Sebastian, I'm seeing you like die over in the corner.
Honestly, look, I know you hate the idea of Hartley as head coach too, which softens the blow. I think my biggest hope is that the coach that the Habs will pick, who will likely succeed Zuchel, there's still a possibility that Zuchel is the head coach, right? Like, like that is definitely still a possibility.
It's still in the
my hope. My hope is just that whoever they hire that has no previous NHL head coaching like experience, because NHL head coaching market is just like GMs. It's always the recycling, right? It's the Vigneault, it's the Therrien, Julien, all these guys. And I know Zuchel was the exact same thing of a non-recycled candidate, but just because that didn't work, I still think the best call would be to go with a more modern approach to the game than Alain Vigneault or Michel Therrien.
Josh, want to give a final thought before we call it a night?
I wouldn't bet against Sharm sticking around, I think, unfortunately. It's going to be sad, but I think we might be stuck with him.
Scott, the final word of the night. It's all yours, buddy. And I think his internet froze. That is the final word of the night. If you guys can see this, I mean, his screen is frozen and he has this little grin with his head tilted on the side and everything. It makes for a great wallpaper. Anyways, okay, well, Scott, whatever your opinion is, I'm sure it's amazing. So we're going to end this on this.
He's gone.
He's gone. All right, well, no worries.
Internet disconnected.
Well, guys, this has been a banger of a show. Thank you very much for all your input. Thank you very much to everyone who's been listening. And we will catch you next week on another episode of Puck and Roll.